So it's gonna be a blackboard kind of day. All right. So.
Perfect.
All right. Yeah, one thing we should establish. I know the final is Saturday, right? What time?
12.
12?
12:30.
12 or 12:30?
11:45.
You'll be there all day, yeah. So it's, it looks like it's 12:30. Is that the consensus? Okay. On Saturday. So, yeah, I'm not thrilled about it. As far as I know, it's in the same room as before. I'm going to double check on that.
Walk in, it's a pre-cal room again.
Oh, man, yeah, who needs that? Yeah.
I mean, I would have took that test. I'm fine with me. I'm not complaining.
Cobra 255. It is 12:30 to 3 o'clock. Yes. Okay. So, same room as before. Alright. Scantron's the same. Yeah, we're not going to switch it on the other way. So, it's a blue one, right? Yeah. Okay. And I forget what's wrong with the green one. I want to say maybe the green one, you can't specify whether it's version A or version B. If you can't specify that, it counts everything wrong. We scan them at the same time. The scanner machine needs to pick out which one's which. And so, yeah, we don't do it by hand, so it makes the grading a lot harder. The usual threat is if it just grades all yours wrong, we might not notice. So, that,
that would suck.
All right. And so I'm putting the whole stack of them in the vending machine up here. You see, they may be all gone by now.
Is the note card the same?
1 3x5. You can write as small as you like, as long as you can read it. Magnifying glass is not allowed. So, no microfilm readers or any of that. So, all right. What's that?
Not type.
It can be typed. Yeah, it can be typed. People were typing them last time. You haven't had any problem with them, I don't think. Yeah, so if you want to type it with a tiny print, that's fine. Yeah, 3x5 inches. So we'll be very clear about that. So yeah, somebody brought in a 3x5 foot on one side. Yeah, so
R squared
meters. Yeah. All right. So yeah, note cards the same as before. Calculator same as before. You couldn't use it before. Don't try and use it again. What else we got? You know what's going to be on it? We've been reviewing for some time. Today's the last day of class, and we're out of old tests and things like that. Are there problems specifically that you wish me to address? That's the main thing. Is there things that that you've been working on? Yeah.
Can you show me how to do this last one? The last one for this part.
Talking about convert a rectangular to a polar, polar to rectangular. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. All right. So. We got one that looks like r cosine of theta equals sine of 2 theta. So we're looking to exploit the idea that x is r cosine of theta and y is r sine of theta, right? So we're trying to isolate things that look like this. So this is definitely an x. What do I do with sine of 2 theta? Yeah, right. This is 2 sine theta cosine theta. Okay. Now, I can replace sine of theta with y divided by r, and cosine theta with x divided by r. And so far I got this, right? So I got x equals 2xy over r squared. What's r squared?
X squared plus y?
Yeah, it's x squared plus y squared. So do you see where I've gotten it down to a place where there's nothing but x's and y's in there now? So that's where you want to get to. You should be able to make this, so R squared equals x squared plus y squared. Cosine theta is x over r. Sine theta is y over r. Do these first, and then replace this if you have to. You should be able to get it into rectangular coordinates. They tend to look like things involving x squared plus y squared, just because you tend to get sort of circular-looking objects with this. So, and I think this is probably, let's see, 2xy is equal to x times x squared plus y squared. Do you see anything you can factor out? Maybe divide both sides by x, right? So this is going to be 2y equals x squared plus y squared. So I think that was one of the choices. So yeah, multiple choice is just a matter of getting it down to something that matches one of the choices.
So like on MLP, they like completed the square, like they subtracted 2y and they completed the square. Like what is that?
No kidding. Okay. So.
Couldn't you just have like replace the x and the
y? Oh, I see. Like they did x squared plus y squared minus 2y equals 0 and then completed the square on y? Okay. So x squared plus y squared minus 2y plus 1 equals 1. So x squared plus what, y minus 1 squared equals 1. I mean, you can, because that tells you that it's a circle centered at 0, 1 with radius 1.
So that's like the same thing?
It's the same thing.
Okay.
Yeah, so if it's multiple choice, it's just a matter of, if this one doesn't show up, start expanding out the ones that are there until you get something that matches. Yeah, remember, if it's multiple choice, you can use the choice and stuff. Yeah, and I'd be surprised if that showed up in a in a show you would, because we didn't spend that much time on it. All right, what else? Okay. Okay. All right, express the Cartesian coordinates and polar coordinates in two different ways. Okay. Okay, so one, negative one. Okay, so. Figure out where is the point 1, negative 1. It's right here, right? So, all right. How do you find r? Should be the distance from the origin to where we are. So it'll be the square root of 1 squared plus negative 1 squared. So square root of 2. Okay. So I could use, so r theta pairs. If I do r is square root of 2 and theta is negative pi over 4, that's the angle that comes down here, right? Because the x and y coordinates are the same size, and so it's going to be a like a 45 degree angle. All right, what's another way I could do it? What's another angle that's in the same place as negative pi over 4? Yeah, I could do negative pi over 4 plus 2 pi, which is 7 pi over 4, so that's another way. I could also do, if r is negative root 2, that means my angle is actually over here, right? And I went the opposite direction for r, so I could do 3 pi over 4, or something like that. So there's actually infinitely many ways you could specify this point in the polar coordinates. Fair enough?
So then you would just plug the graph and figure
it out. There's no specific formula. Yeah, it's about it. The, I mean, technically, what is it? R is the square root of x squared plus y squared, and theta is the inverse tangent of y over x. So you could get it that way, and that'll get you one of the points, but honestly, I think just drawing it out is probably the easiest way to do it. Alright, major topics we had. Do you remember how to do integration by parts wraparound stuff?
Ooh.
Remember those? You want to do one?
Heck yeah.
Okay, let's do one. Alright, so suppose I needed to find the integral of e to the 3x sine of 5x. And let me do sine of 4x. Okay. Alright, so what do you do with this thing?
Break it
up into two parts. What do you want to integrate? What do you want to differentiate? Let me integrate the e to the 3x because I'm probably going to get the signs wrong on the trig function if I try to integrate. So if I do u is sine of 4x, dv is e to the 3x, that means du is going to be what? 4 cosine of 4x. So it's the coefficient out front to cancel. V is going to be 1/3 e to the 3x. Okay. So I know this becomes uv, which is 1/3 e to the 3x sine of 4x minus integral of v du, which is 4/3 integral of e to the 3x cosine of 4x. Alright, so what do you do with this guy? Integration by parts. So, how do you pick your u and your dv? Yeah, same rules, right? Let's let u be the trig function, cosine of 4x, and dv be the other one, which is e to the 3x. That means du is going to be negative 4 sine of 4x, v is going to be 1/3 e to the 3x. So this now becomes 1/3 e to the 3x sine of 4x minus 4/3 of something in brackets, which is 1/3 e to the 3x cosine of 4x minus the integral of v du, so plus the integral of 4/3 e to the 3x sine of 4x. Okay. So this is supposed to be where the magic happens.
Right answer.
So what I started with is now equal to 1/3 e to the 3x sine of 4x minus, looks like 4/9 e to the 3x cosine of 4x minus, looks like 16/9 times the integral I started with. Okay, so what's the magic?
Add it to the other side.
Yep. Add this whole term to both sides. So what's your coefficient? This tells us that 1 plus 16 over 9, because I got one copy here and 16/9 of a copy there, times the integral I started with, is equal to the stuff that's left over. Okay, so what do I divide by? If there was no coefficients, it'd be 2, but it's whatever this thing is, right? This is, what, 9 plus 16 is 25/9? So I need to multiply both sides by 9/25. Okay, so I'm going to multiply by 9/25 here and here. I can, as long as I do the same thing on both sides, I can do whatever I need to. And that'll tell me that the integral that I want, which is e to the 3x sine of 4x, is what? 9/25 times a third is 3/25 e to the 3x sine of 4x minus, this will be what? 4/25 e to the 3x cosine of 4x. Okay, that's the whole thing. Let's see. So,
where's your 4/9 go? Oh, wait. Okay.
Yeah, because 4/9 times 25, or times 9/25, yeah. So, all right, so what's the patterns you notice? The coefficients 3 and 4 show up on your numerators here. Your denominator is always the sum of squares of those two numbers, right? If you do 3 squared plus 4 squared, you get 25. That's always what shows up in the denominator. So there's a few sort of flags that you can look for in that kind of thing. So, and I've seen a number of things like this. The one for, I think, what did they put on the first test? Was it secant cubed or secant times tangent squared or something like that? And it's a wraparound like this where you have to do some trick stuff. All right. What else have we not seen in a while? What about the stuff in the very beginning that was U subs made out of trig functions? Remember that? If I get like a power of tangent times a power of secant, you remember those things? So what if I got the integral of secant to the fifth times tangent cubed? Okay. So we had two methods for dealing with these, right? Either you could peel off a secant squared and convert everything over to tangents, or you could peel off a secant and a tangent and convert everything over to secants. Which one's going to be easier this way?
Oh.
Oh.
Peeling off a secant, or is it a tangent? I hate true false.
If I peel off a secant squared, let's look at our options, right? Because remember, the thing you peel off is always a derivative of somebody, right? You want to peel off whatever it's going to be the du. So if I peel off a secant squared, what I've got left is a secant cubed. I've got an odd power of secant, and that's going to be hard to convert over into tangents without fractional powers and stuff. So let me peel off one of these here. Got secant to the fourth times tangent squared times secant x tangent x. Now, whose derivative is this? Yeah, this is a derivative of secant, right? And so if I can convert everything over to secants, I can do this as a u sub. All right, so I've got secant to the fourth. Tangent squared is secant squared something 1. Plus or minus? I think it's minus, yeah. Secant squared minus 1. All right, times secant x tangent x. Dx. Okay. So what's your u substitution? Got to be secant x, right? Because I've got something that's made of secants and then a derivative of secant sitting out there. So that means du is going to be secant x tangent x. Alright, and so this thing turns into the integral of u to the fourth times u squared minus 1 du, which is now very easy to integrate. Just multiply it out. Alright, here's the silly things people miss. What's u to the fourth times u squared? U to the sixth, not u to the eighth, right? So u to the sixth minus u to the fourth. So it's not the calc that gets people, it's the pre-calc. So if I integrate this, I get what? 1/7 u to the 7th minus 1/5 u to the 5th. All right. Which we didn't have any limits on this one. So I've got 1/7 secant to the 7th minus 1/5 secant to the 5th. Plus c. Okay. So there's that step.
How much are you going to lose for forgetting the C?
I don't know, half a point. Right. So it's not much, right? Our aim on the final exam is, you know, small errors should be sort of like bee stings against your grade, not like, you know, dog bites against your grade. So. Hey, I was going to say, yeah, that analogy falls apart if you're allergic to bees or something. Yeah, so.
I mean.
So. I don't know, are dog bites worse if you're allergic to dogs?
I'm just thinking about the long-term mental effects. If you get bit by a dog, a chihuahua.
Yeah, no, I'll admit, yeah, I was afraid of dogs for a long time.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, so...
Come on.
I get that. I was also afraid of bees for a long time. I don't know. Very nice, yeah, yeah. Never got stung by a C though. So, alright.
Let's see, I had another example of something.
Oh. Okay. What's interesting about this? An improper integral, right? We might not tell you it's an improper integral. This class has a pretty good history of writing the word improper in big capital letters, so they probably will, but that is an improper integral, and I've seen this take place on multiple choice problems, right? If you had that one that was the integral from 0 to 2 of 1 over x minus 1 to the 4th, you got burned by that, right? That's definitely going to diverge, right? So... the blows up, right? So the it diverges. So don't get burned by those things. Do make sure that you're not integrating across an asymptote or something like that. How would you do this one? This is what the limit as x or as c goes to 0 of the integral from c to 5 of log of x over x. Okay. All right, how would you go about integrating this thing anyway?
Yeah.
Suppose I let u be log of x, means du is going to be 1 over x dx, which I have. And so this is the limit as c goes to 0. You know what? Let's do this on some scrap paper. This is going to tell us that the integral of log of x over x dx is the same as the integral of what, u du? Which is 1 half u squared, which is 1 half log of x squared. Okay, so what I've got is the limit of c.